Whereabouts in Virginia do you live?
Lexington.
Where is that?
About 300 miles south of Washington. I live there for three reasons. One, I was born near there many, many years ago. And two, I have seen a fair piece of the world, but I don't know any fairer piece than the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia. And three, Lexington is home of VMI and Washington and Lee, so I have these grand research resources there.
Yeah, well, I noticed you set a good part of Spangled in Virginia, and one of your heroes keeps talking about going to VMI to teach.
You've actually read the thing?
Well, I haven't finished it. If you would have written it a little shorter, I might have. But yes, I am. I'm thoroughly enjoying the book. It's.
I'm sorry, but I have got typecast now as a writer of doorstop-sized novels, and my publishers just won't let me do anything smaller nowadays.
Well, I want to talk about Spangle more specifically in a moment, but I'd like to talk about you and find out how all this began. You were born at Lexington?
Very near there.
Near Lexington?
In the country.
What year were you born?
1928, back shortly before the flood.
That was a very, very good year, especially for you. You came into the world. What did your parents do?
My father was a printer, and at the age of 12, I was his printer's devil, hand-setting type and a job stick. So I've been sort of associated with words all my life. Later on, in my teens, I went into advertising. Got interrupted there by being drafted for the Korean War. The Army made me a war correspondent, gave me a Jeep and a carbine and a portable typewriter and sort of said, go be Bill Malden. So I saw the whole Korean War from the front lines to the prisoner of war camps down south. And when I came back, I went into advertising, but some of my Korean stuff had got picked up by the wire services, and I'd been bylined over here, so I was able to get an agent. And I wrote, in my spare time, I wrote short stories and articles, and quite a few of them got published. And eventually, as everybody does, I began to loathe advertising. And one day just said, the hell with it, if I'm ever going to make a move as a freelance, now's the time. And I just walked out of advertising and starved for a good many years. But
did you go to VMI?
No. My only education was in art school, because I originally went into advertising as a commercial artist.
Oh.
But I discovered two things. One was that I had more facility than talent, and the other was that the copy department got paid a damn sight better than the art department did. So I was gradually weaseled my way over into the copy department.
Where in advertising did you work?
Oh, I've been with most of the Madison Avenue agencies. You know how it is, 18 months in one, 2 years in another. I was with Kleppner, BBDO, several you probably never heard of.
So you spent a good many years here in New York City, huh?
Oh, yes, 20 or thereabouts, in total, with interruptions.
But it was a cultural clash. You kept yearning for that pretty country in Virginia.
Oh, no, never yearning, really. When I left New York the last time, for good, that is, I went to Mexico and spent 12 years down there writing, researching, and then writing my first doorstop novel, Aztec, and that was my breakthrough. Up until then, I'd been earning a subsistence living. Aztec made me at least solvent.
Oh, I sure did. Well, let's go back and tell me about your first work of fiction, which was not, as you say, a doorstop novel. That was The Journeyer?
Oh, no.
No. Aztec was your first book, wasn't it?
No, it was not. I don't have everything on the card there.
Oh, well, tell me about those that don't appear on the card.
Oh, I did a dozen or so juvenile, adult, that is, fiction and nonfiction. And I've done a sort of philology for the layman for adults. And that was recently republished as World of Words. And then I did a couple of short novels, which made more money actually on Hollywood options than they ever did as books. They have yet to come to the screen, but people keep still picking them up at various studios out yonder. And I've done tons of magazine work for National Geographic, Reader's Digest, and a lot of short stories. But when I started on Aztec, I knew that that was going to be my breakthrough, because it was a novel that nobody had ever done before. There have been novels about the Aztecs, but they mainly consisted of the conquest, the clash of cultures.
Why did you become interested in the Aztecs?
Well, I was living among them, for one thing.
Well, were you there to live? I mean, you didn't go to Mexico just to research Aztec.
No, that notion came to me after I got there. I went down there because on a freelance writer's income, you can live pretty well in Mexico, far better than you can in New York. And while I was there, I simply noticed that there were very few novels on the Aztecs, and they all mainly dealt with the conquest, and I decided to go back 40, 50, 60 years before the Aztecs had ever known that there was such a thing as a white man, and tell something about what they were like in their, at the height of their civilization.
Yeah, that really was a breakthrough novel for you, and I understand you even learned the Aztec language?
It's called Nahuatl. Yes, I did.
That's not still being spoken, though, is it?
Yes, it is.
It is.
Yeah, I managed to get along adequately among the Nahuatl speakers, but there are some 60 different pre-Columbian languages still spoken in Mexico. I don't know how exact the demographic figures are, but somebody has calculated that something like 65% of Mexicans do not yet speak Spanish. And so in some of these out-of-the-way boondock places where I went to do my research, I would have to have a Spanish interpreter along to just be able to communicate. Among the Nahuatl speakers, I got along all right, but when you get down and put places with strange languages like Tzotzil and Chamula and things like that, I had to have somebody along.
How long did you spend researching Aztec?
12 years.
12 years?
Well, it need not have taken so long, but as I say, I was living marginally as a freelance writer, so I had to do a lot of hack work in the meantime just for subsistence, and whenever I wanted to take a journey, say, into the desert or down to the jungles or whatever, I'd sort of have to save up my money until I could afford to go. And I was supported by no funds, grants, endowments, anything like that. I was doing it purely on my own. And finally, the time came when I had a ton of notes and tapes and photographs and things and thought, now or never. So I called my agent in New York and said, can you get me an advance that will allow me for 1, maybe 2 years, just to put myself 500 years back in the past into a culture that is as alien to ours as the Martian would be, and not be interrupted by any deadlines, commissions, hack work, journeys for the National Geographic, whatever. And fortunately, she was able to sell the thing on the basis of an outline, and I got... Well, you know how chintzy publishers are. They sort of said, we'll give you $5,000 every time you come up with 250 acceptable pages, sort of thing. But by the time I was halfway through it, they knew what they had, and we renegotiated the contract, and from then on it's been easy street, more or less.
Doesn't a novelist take a risk in blending fact and fiction in the way that you did in Aztec?
It's not a risk, it's rather difficult. I've got all kinds of letters from people saying how much of this is fact and how much is fiction. Well, I created fictional characters, but there are factual ones in there as well, and I adhered closely to every fact that was available. Whenever there's an eclipse in there or a comet appears in the sky, you can damn well bet that I know it appeared on that date. All the other details of the religious ceremonies and things, sacrifices and whatnot, I researched most thoroughly, and they're not still holding human sacrifices in New York, but at New York, good God, in Mexico.
Well, sometimes they do. All the wonderful days, those were the days of the human sacrifices.
But they do still sacrifice piglets and lambs and roosters and that sort of thing to the various old gods. Catholicism down there is a very thin veneer over the old religions, I can tell you.
Well, let's bring the story up to date with Spangle. You must have had some great interest in the circus. What gave you the idea for Spangle?
Well, once again, it was one of those books nobody's ever really done. When if you think of, you know, think of a circus novel, what do you think of? Toby Tyler's 10 Weeks of the Circus.
Yeah.
And that was written in something like 1898, and it was a children's book, and those were Victorian times, very pussy-footy, and so they hardly gave a true picture of the circus, and I thought I'd try. and all the circus people.
How did you go about researching this? There must be a lot of information. You probably went down to Sarasota?
No, I...
Do they have a museum down there, circus museum?
The big circus museum is up in Baraboo, Wisconsin.
Oh.
Sarasota's the winter quarters for quite a number of circuses. The first thing I needed was a real mud show, because my circus starts out as a raggle-taggle, raggedy-ass bunch of nothings. And fortunately, I was able to find a real mud show. It was just starting up its first season. And it was pathetic enough to serve my purposes. You know, they didn't carry their own crew of roustabouts. And whatever town they came to, they just scour the streets for the town drunks and hire them to put up the canvas. And
wait a minute, are you saying you joined the circus?
Oh, I traveled with 9 of them altogether.
You traveled with 9 circuses?
2 here in the States and 7 in Europe and Russia. Oh, yes, I spent a whole year with the circus.
What name did they give you? What uniform?
Oh, I don't mean I did anything. I shoveled a lot of elephant manure.
Of course, in Spangle, anybody joins the circus is given a new name and a uniform and shown how to do something.
No, I was just another rube as far as they were concerned, but they were most hospitable, warm. They're the friendliest people on earth. And they let me participate insofar as, practically anything I asked to do, they'd let me do. I've been in the cage with the cats during the wild animal acts, and just as a supernumerary, standing around with a whip looking silly. But I've served as the target for a knife thrower in the sideshow.
A friendly knife thrower, I hope?
I'm still here. And, what else?
Let me ask you, the circus in the 19th century that you describe in Spangle, isn't that a lot different from the circuses that you toured with?
It is, of course. And I had to do a great deal of historical research on that in that respect. Excuse me. I remember once in Italy I was having dinner with a trapeze family, and they were saying something like, well, you know, our act wouldn't have been much different 100 years ago, and I had to correct them. I said, the hell it wouldn't. back in 100 years ago, Leotard had first done the leap from one trapeze to another. Before that, it'd been just acrobatics on one hanging trapeze. He was the first one to do a leap, and now you're doing triple and quadruple somersaults between them. And he would not have had all this chromium plating that you've got, and the strobe lights, and the glitzy amplified music, and so forth. And the artiste said, "Per Bacco, you're right. I never thought of that." So,
I was surprised. You mentioned leotard. Here they're wearing leotards in Spangle. Here's the 19th century, and I guess I hadn't thought very much about it. But I, as I think about acrobats in the 19th century, and you think of the Puritan approach that they had toward life, you wonder about that. But apparently in the circus they were pretty open about it, huh?
Well, on the same theory that acting was considered just one cut above street walking, you know, all the lady actresses took names like Mrs. Sidden and Mrs. Campbell and so forth to give them an aura of respectability. Circus folk were considered just about a cut above gypsy tinsmiths coming through town and stealing chickens and things. So they were allowed to get away with a bit of raunch, you might say.
You have so many facts, like the, I can't remember the name of it, but the little piece of material that the acrobats wear between their legs, both the male and the female. You have so many facts about, well, I think there's a, you go into detail about how a six-shooter works, and on and on and on and on. Where did you get all of this information?
Well, when I decided to have a Confederate officer join the circus as a shootist, I began to wonder, how sharply can you shoot with those old weapons? And so I went out and bought some. I got me an 1857 Remington cap and ball revolver, the same as he uses, and a Cook carbine. And got the gunsmith to show me how to load these things, and went out and practiced with them. Turns out you can shoot pretty damn sharp with those things. I really do go into my research rather deeply.
You really immersed yourself in that, didn't you? How long in researching did you do?
That's a little hard to say, because I first thought of doing a circus novel sometime back in the 60s when it looked like the circus was disappearing forever. And I was sort of thinking of doing a monument to a vanished institution. So it was back then that I began collecting everything I could find on circuses. But I spent a year of legwork everywhere from Nashville to Leningrad. And